Hello everybody, good afternoon. So I am starting the lecture on stack semantics and intermediate code generation, which is a part of the compiler construction course. So begin with, you have access to the slides which I have put up, but the slides are for the entire three lecture course. I'll cover a part of it today. But before I begin, let me give you some feel about the context of this particular module. Since you know that this is a part of compilers and it is not the first module, so I'll have to assume that you know about lexical and syntax analysis reasonably well. Okay? If you have gone through my earlier module or if you have gone through any other course at a different place, that's okay with me. Whatever I need, I'll try and quickly review. However, I assume that you know at least one parsing method well, and preferably a bottom-up parser. Okay? Even top-down parser is okay, but a bottom-up parser is preferred, because semantics will be built on top of a parser, as we will show you. So the context is that you know something about compilers, the front-end, lexical analyzer and parser. Secondly, you are somewhat familiar with some programming language. Okay, C is assumed to be the basic language. However, since semantic issues are not very well addressed only through C, I'll pick up snippets of other programming languages which offer better challenges in semantic analysis. Okay, so C will be the driving language, but I'll do pick up instances from other languages which are a little more complex than C. Secondly, this is, as you know, compiler is a very practical course. So it will be very difficult for me to only teach you theory. Okay? So what I'll be doing is, once I get into the full phase of the course, I'll be using the theoretical concepts, but always they are built up on practical knowledge. So what I'll do is I'll start the course with some examples which I have prepared separately. I'll use those slides to show you and give you some feel about how to test the ideas that you learn in this course. So this being a practical subject, you have to learn theory and you have to practice. And the only way one can practice, or perhaps the best way one can practice, is to use a compiler and a language that you are familiar with. Okay. So I'll begin with some simple experiments. Since I cannot conduct them on the fly, online, I have taken snippets, I have run some programs to show you, and this is how I am going to start my course. So before I begin with that, since I am not sure of the complete composition of the participants, okay, you are most welcome to raise a flag if there is a doubt anytime during the lecture in progress, and I'll try and address your doubts as soon as I can. You can either use the chat, or even you can raise your hand and we can try a video interactive session. So please do not hesitate to ask questions, because otherwise it will be difficult to come back once we are gone past a certain stage. So I will be very happy to entertain as many questions as you pose them during this phase. But I'd also like to say that you should not ask questions too much beyond the subject. I have no problem answering, but then that will slow down my material. For example, questions directly on parsing or the internals, question directly on phases that follow semantic analysis like optimization, code generation, etc. is not, this is not the forum for that. Okay? If there is a quick question, I can take an answer, but I don't want to devote too much time on them, but concentrate mainly on semantic analysis, which is a heavy phase in a compiler. A lot of work gets done here, as you will see. So I will start by saying that since this is a practical course, choice but to get into the pool, okay, wet your feet and then get a feel of the subject. So please learn from practice. All your theoretical knowledge will get much better clarified. So I am going to use for demonstration or for illustration mostly right now from C language, and I'm going to use the public domain GNU CCC compiler. which is called GCC. If you have access to it, it will be great, because then we will be on the same wavelength. So if you have doubts or if you get into errors, then I will be able to analyze your errors exactly the way I would see them. However, if you have a different language and a different operating system, then things may be a little different. So I am using Ubuntu and GCC, and most of my observations are based on that. Okay. So if you are not familiar with GCC, it's a standard C compiler. Okay. What you see over here is the way I would like you to run the programs. I'll tell you why. This is not the standard way of running a GCC compiler. Usually you would run GCC with proc.c and you will be happy with it, where proc.c is a C compiler. Okay, so this is really required. These two are mandated. The other options that you see are very useful if you are going through a compiler course. So the first thing that you see, which reads minus f dump minus 3 minus all, is a contiguous word, no blanks in between, is an intimation to the compiler that please show me all the intermediate dumps that are produced by the compiler. Okay, I'll show you a few of them. So it allows you to explore the compiler, how the compiler has done something, and some part of it I'll use throughout this three lecture module. Okay, the next one, minus f verbose minus asm, allows you to produce assembly code in a verbose mode and look at a verbose assembly. So why verbose? Because otherwise assembly code is very difficult to read. So the compiler generates assembly code with some comments and therefore makes assembly reading useful. And if you do the back end of a compiler optimization, code generation later, then you will find that this switch gives you a direct dump of the assembly code, which you can see at leisure. To actually produce the assembly code in GCC, we use minus capital S to tell the compiler, please generate the assembly code. So I've only used three options here, minus F dump pre-all, minus F verbose ASM, and minus capital S. Again, I've told you the purpose of each one of them. But in general, I'll ask you to find out all many other options which GCC gives, and therefore you make your life more easy when you run the compiler, and you can also use the compiler to get a lot of information about your program. So a better compiler usage, you should look at many other options of GCC. But in this course, the semantics part of it, since I'm interested, what I will show you as we go along is that this is a multi-pass compiler. So GCC does around 200 passes of the source program, which means that it processes our program at about 200 plus times and does various things before it finally generates the assembly. We are in the front end, and you can see I'm going to look at only passes 3 and 4. 3 I'm also not going to look at, but I'll ask you to see it. My main focus will be pass 4. So why I'm showing you this? Because I want to show to you what GCC does for a simple sample program up to pass 4. What does it produce? Okay, and how can we learn the compiler course to do the same thing ourselves? So whatever it does up to pass 4 is some of the purpose behind this module that I'm doing. Okay. After that, GCC does something very, very different. So here is a simple program. Let's see if you can see all of it. The program is not at all complex, nor is it supposed to be. Okay, so there is an int main. Observe that there are two integer variables declared, A and B. They are also initialized. There are two floating point numbers or float variables, x and y. X is not initialized, but y is initialized. An arithmetic expression x is assigned, is given in the next statement, which is a plus b star y minus y star y. This is computed and assigned to the variable x, floating point variable x, and then it prints x. So very little, four variables used, one expression computed and printed, and that's all this program does. We want to know what the compiler does for it by taking one snapshot of this program as the compiler processes it. So I'll assume that you will use my GCC, whatever I had given you, all those options with GCC. If you're using other compiler, please figure out how to do that in your compiler. So once you do this GCC minus F dump 3 all, it will produce the output of many passes. For example, you see on the slide expr.c.003t. This means it's the dump of the third pass of GCC, and dot original, what comes afterwards, gives you some idea about what this dump has. So it says it's the dump of the original program after some processing by the GCC. So I'm not going to answer this, what exactly GCC does in original, but it will be good for you if you take the source code, any source code written by you, and look at the original and the source code and compare and see what the compiler has done. Okay. I will continue with the fourth pass. So I'm going to show you what is there in expr.c, the same file name, .004t.gimple. Okay, so if you do not know, let me tell you that Gimple is another language. It's neither a high level language like C nor a low level language like assembly, but an intermediate code language, okay, which we'll study in the course later. We'll not study Gimple, we'll study something else. So Gimple is the intermediate code language for GCC. However, we should be able to make some sense out of it as I show it. So here is now the content of code in, let me just adjust it a little bit, in the 004t. I'm showing you a part of it. I'll open up more as you go along. First, you can observe that my concentration is only to see what did it do to understand and translate this expression x equals, you've seen right. First, observe, we'll figure out during the course why. I'm just giving you some dump to show you what it does. Hows will come later. You observe there are some funny names, d.2290, d.2291, etc. And these are all floating point variables. In other words, the compiler has introduced five new variables which I as user never wrote. Followed by it uses a double variable which is d.2295, again not used by me in my program. And it introduced a new integer. So the moral of this part of the story is that a compiler introduces or chooses to introduce new variables while trying to translate our source code. Okay, so why does it introduce temporary? What are their roles? Would be something that we have to study in this course as we go. Okay, so introduction of new temporaries, new variables, we call them temporaries, to translate our program. Now look at some of the other stuff. Int A, int B, float X, float Y, A equals 5, B equals 10, etc. were already given in my program. So the compiler hasn't done too much. Except that observe, I have said Y equals 1.5. The compiler has translated this to 1.5 E plus 0. So it has changed the representation to some standard floating point representation, which was okay. After that, you observe that there are some assignments to these new variables created by the compiler. So d.2290 takes the operand A or the variable A, which happens to be an integer, and that bracket float, I'm sure you know in C, is converted to floating point value. So A is converted to float, the float value is kept. B is converted to float, and the value is stored in some two new variables created. Okay. Some intuition as to why is it doing all that. Probably if you go and if you look at the first instruction it issues, which is just below this, d.2292 equals d.2291 into y. And if you go up, you can see that b star y is basically what the compiler does first. I hope you remember parsing, and therefore you can figure out the parse tree for x equals a plus b star y minus y star y will end up first evaluating b star y. This the compiler has figured out. It also figures out by looking at b star y. Okay, maybe I'll draw a small parse tree here to show you so that you are not lost in what I am saying. So this is the compiler dump. I write down the expression again. The expression we are looking at happens to be a plus b, hope you can see, star y minus y star y. And remember that the types of a and b are float, whereas the types of y and x happen to be, sorry, a and b are integers, x and y are float. So what will the parse tree for this, ignoring everything? So here is b. Okay, in the parse order, it will do b star y. Okay, then it will add it to a, left to right order. Then it will do a subtraction of this with y star y. Okay, and this whole thing will be assigned to x. This is parsing, nothing to do with semantics, which is the main topic of my modules in this particular module. So this the syntax analyzer or parser will do. Okay, and since the string happens to belong to the proper grammar, he'll pass this. Now, once the semantic analyzer looks at it, he is not happy with the parsing, or he's not happy with the complete parse tree in this sense. You observe that b happens to be an integer or int, y happens to be a float, and these are two different types which cannot be married directly without any extra effort. This is okay, you can't marry b into y. Why? Because there are different hardware units. Floating point multiplication uses a different, you know, unit at the hardware level. Integer multiplication is a different hardware unit. And there is no hardware unit which can multiply an integer to a float. So the language is already decided. If you give me such mixed mode entities, then one of them is changed. In this case, the integer is to be converted to a float, and this star becomes a float star. The real arithmetic floating point unit will take into picture, and this will go through. Observe that y happens to be float. Y happens to be float. So this, without any effort, is actually the floating point star anyway. So the floating multiplication unit will take care of this. Now when you come to a and b, this a is integer and b is coming out to be a float because of the conversion, there is again a problem. So this fellow will again convert this into a float, and thereby this will become a float plus. This is all the purpose of semantic analysis that we are trying to do. So when there is an expression which is not compatible, the compiler will have to do some work, which we'll see today in greater detail, doing type checking. So it will check type of every small primitive expression, b star y, a assigned b, a less than equal to b, whatever you give, it will type check, and if the type checking passes, it decides what to do. If it does not type check properly, it tries conversions, which is what it is doing. So observe in this, the rules of C say, if an operand is not matching with that of the other operand, then you have to do some promotion or demotion based on the language. In this case, B is to be converted to float, A is to be converted to float, and then the operation can go through. Okay? All these are details provided by the C language, and therefore, along with parsing, as we will see later, all these conversions are mandated. A is converted to float, saved in a temporary. B is converted to float, saved in a temporary. Please note that neither A or B have changed. A continues to be an integer, B continues to be an integer, but D.2290 and 2291 have the floating point equivalent value of those. And then therefore you can see that this 2291 is done, is the floating point multiplication taking place. Okay, and he has already converted A already to 2290. So this addition is a floating point addition. So what I was trying to basically tell you was that even a simple expression. In fact, expressions are the most complex things for semantic analysis. You know, makes us work a lot before it can actually convert. So this single expression was slowly broken down by the compiler into meaningful small statements, which is the intermediate code GIMPL that I showed you. So what you see here, or what I showed you here, intuitively all of us can read, but actually it belongs to that language GIMPL. In this course, we will use some different lines. So at this point, I'll give you my first exercise in some sense, not to do now, but to do later, is to use a compiler. I'll be very happy if you can use GCC, but if you cannot, then use whatever you have at your disposal. Okay. And so for example, look at another one. So it asks you to write many small fragments of pieces. In this code, there is nothing. The only interesting point is we want to understand what happens in translation. So I have tried to use an if-then-else statement. If is followed by a condition, which if evaluating to true, you do whatever is in the then part, the curly braces. If the condition is not true, we do in the else part. This is how we write in the source. What does the compiler do? Lots of checks and balances, but at the end of it, it will generate code, in intermediate code, which will match us. So here is one which I'm going to show you before I start my course for them. So for example, if you gave the command to GCC and said, please show me the GIMPL code after your semantic analyzer has gone through, this is what it shows. So you observe that he also has an if clause, but there is no then and else. These are go-tos. The low-level primitive instructions which it has. If a is less than or equal to b, it says go to 2290, and 2290 is the red one which you see here. Once it reaches here, it executes certain instructions. But at the end, it says go to 2296. It jumps to another point in the code. This is the then part. If this is not true in else, there is another go to. You transfer the control to 2291. You do that, there is no other transfer of control. It falls through after what is there in the then part. Who has done all this? The compiler. So it has translated an if then else into an if go to kind of statement with lots of labels. Why? Because this form is very similar or close to actual machine or assembly instructions. So converting from here to assembly is much more simpler as compared to this. So what should you do? I would suggest that start writing small pieces of code, a function call, a for loop, just one each, a small do loop, while loop, a switch statement, just separately compile them and look at the GIMPL code to see how the compiler has broken up your source into a much more manageable but probably unreadable, not so easy to read, intermediate. This whole course is about the tricks and techniques that the compiler uses, skipping the parsing part, but along with parsing, how does it go about generating these GIMPL kind of code and what sort of analysis it does. This is the purpose of semantic analysis, finding out the meaning of a program and converting it wherever required into a simpler form which is 100% equivalent to the source. If there's an error, then it will not do this. It will show you errors. Any questions here you can ask. So now I'll formally get into the slide material. So I'm saying, please write small pieces of code, run through the compiler, observe dumps to get a feel of how actually semantic analysis is done. Okay, how probably you will not understand what it does in semantic analysis in the compiler. That will give you very good intuition when we actually study the techniques by virtue of which it does the translation. Okay, so here is the end of the small extra slides part, hopefully to motivate you. We are in a practical scenario, and since GCC is public domain, GCC Ubuntu, GCC, any Linux software should give you the same feel that I've given you to I've given to you so far. Any quick questions? You can use any form. I'll give you a minute. If there are any questions at this stage, please feel free to ask. Because all my course, I'll be doing only this. I will not go beyond intermediate course, but I look at a variety of linguistic constructs in C, beyond C, other languages, and try and see what is the trick of understanding the meaning of those code fragments, and then secondly, how to convert it to intermediate code, which has the same meaning as the original. Okay, since there are no questions, let me go to my slide material. So I'll go to the first slide, gives you basically the layout that I have thought of doing. It is only a plan. I have no compulsion of completing what I have said, or I can complete more. It all depends on how much you are comfortable with the ideas, whether you are stuck with questions or not. Okay, so I'll try to maintain a gentle pace, but please interact and tell me if the pace is slow, I can speed up. If the pace is fast, I can explain more. It's totally up to you to drive the pace and the content of the lecture. So slide 2 is the information material, so I will not do anything. Okay, slide 3 is basically some of the context which I've already said in which this module will be done. You can read it up and tell me later if there are any problems with this. So it will be nice if you know an LLR parser, but it's not mandatory. And what is outside the scope of this module, I have stated very explicitly. But still, if you have very urgent doubts, you are welcome to ask. So I'm really starting my this particular module with slide number 4, which takes a snippet of a program, okay, and tries to give you what the compiler does, what my compiler does, what my compiler on my laptop does, and try and understand what it has done. Okay? So without knowing how it does, I don't want you to know. We try to guess as a user what's wrong with this program or what's right with the program and how did the compiler detect it. Okay? That's more important. So the program is there before you. A assigned B, B assigned 10, return 0. So my compiler, again, there could be variations if you change the stuff. Says P1C410 is the location of the error in the program P1.C, which is the name of this program. Line number 4, it says character number 10, all these are details, undeclared, first used in this function. And it shows A assigned B, and there is a caret symbol under equality assignment, which says this is the. So observe that this compiler has figured out that A assigned B is not okay in this program, okay, even though if you look at it grammatically, there is nothing wrong with it. A assigned B is a perfectly okay sentence in the language C by the grammar of the language. So really speaking, there is no syntax error here. There is a type, which is A, there is a variable, which is A, there is an assignment operator, which is there. On the right hand side of assignment, there must be something. There is something is written called B and semicolon. Structurally, this is fine. So how did the compiler figure out this is not okay? Because you put the same statement after in B equal to 10, he will say this is fine, no error. So this he has done through what we are going to learn in this course called semantic analysis. So intuitively, what you have done, it said, okay, here's a variable A being declared, its type is int, and it is initialized with B. Once you are initializing with B, the compiler is trying to now figure out in this context what is B. And then he says, I don't know what is B. So B has not been declared. This is not syntax analysis, this is semantic analysis. A equals B is wrong because at this point there is no definition. So by the meaning of this sentence is suspect, but if you put it somewhere else, it is fine. So this is grammatically fine, but semantically does not make sense. So this is essentially an instance of a semantic error, yeah, not a syntax error. If you have doubts, you can ask. I can clarify later. Okay, because the distinction is subtle. It all depends on who wrote the grammar and what things he wrote inside. Okay, so take another example. This is cut across the slide, but let's look at it. It says float B, and then it says int B equals 10. Yeah, and there is something after that, nothing. And this program's errors are also listed out to you. Conflicting types for int B to sign 10. Previous declaration was float B. So again, showing that syntactically or grammatically, both the two statements are error free. But when you put them together, they have a problem with the meaning of interpretation of the variable B. Is it float or is it int? What do you want it to be? And the language is not happy. For the user of the program, if you go back on slide 1, it first says float is B, and then it says B is int. It does not like the same variable, and as we'll see later, in the same scope being attempted to be redefined or redeclared. So again, it's a meaningfully, this is not making sense. Grammatically, this is fine. Float B is float, so is the next line saying B is int. But combined together, they are not making any sense meaning wise. So this is a semantic. Similarly, I'm going to skip now. I have given you a lot of other program instances. What I would love you to do at leisure, once the lecture is over on your system, run these small programs, see if they give you an error. If they give you an error, figure out what is that error, okay, and try and explain the error in terms of, is it a lexical error? Because you know lexical analysis. Could it be a syntax error? Which means only the grammar is wrong, it is not matching up to the grammar of C, or is it a semantic error, which means that it's grammatically fine, but there is some problem with the meaning assigned to this sentence of this variable. So lots of them are there for you. So I leave it to you to examine them. For example, I can explain, if you are quick at it, what is wrong with P4.C? Can I have an answer for some of you? Is this okay or is it not okay? And if it is not okay, where is it not okay? What is it, a lexical error? If there is an error, if there is no error, no issues. If there is an error, where does the error belong to? Which pass of the compiler? Sorry, which phase of the compiler? Lexical, syntax, semantics, or beyond? And why? Why is that error? Anyone volunteering? Why do you think P4.C has an error, and what is the nature of the error? P4.C and why? But the main thing is to actually not run and analyze. Then it is great fun. Okay, so let me give you answer to this only. The rest I will not give. You should find out. Maybe tell me later or through other means, mail or discussions. So P4.C, to summarize, as a human being reads it, there is a void swap int comma int definition of a function swap, which is void, it doesn't return anything, and it takes two integer parameters, int and int. That's it. So what it returns, what it takes is given. This is called a prototype declaration of a function. Okay, so I got an answer. The answer is indeed correct. But what is the error? Great. Yes, the function is not defined. It has been declared only. But what is the problem? Which part of the compiler has a problem? Okay, so the answer may vary slightly from one implementation to the other. So the problem is the compiler, when it is going to the program, is observing the type of swap. Okay, I'll do this in more detail later. Swap is a function which takes two integer parameters, returns nothing. There's no other declaration here outside the main. It gets inside the main and it finds that everything is grammatically correct. I is 5, j is 6. The function swap is called with two integer parameters, so it matches the declaration. Return 0 is a perfectly all right statement. So main has no issues. It's a correct use of a function called to swap. The declaration of swap is there. Compiler says perfectly all right, I have no issues with this. The compiler doesn't know. Compiler doesn't know whether the definition of swap will come from another file or somewhere. He's just looking at this file and saying, this file is perfectly compilation error free. If you do GCC minus C, he will not even complain about any error. The compiler passes through, but that's not the end of the road. The compiler has only said, has generated some kind of code and has said, this is okay. When you go to the next stage, the linker has to say, for every function that you have used, I need a definition. So the linker will click. What do I call at the point of swap? this file does not have, no one else has it. So post compiler, which is also essentially sometimes treated as a part of compiler, another module which is linking the calls to every function, including IO calls, other library calls, will figure out that there is no definition of swap and therefore trip. Okay. So it is an error, but it's strictly not a compiler error. You have honored the rules of the language, but you have not defined. And that error may come in a different phase, not in semantics, not in syntax, not in lexical, but somewhere. Okay, so these distinctions you will have to start making as you keep understanding the compiler more and more better. Okay, so let me move on. The other programs you should run at your own leisure, figure out the errors. If you cannot explain, get back to me, then we meet next week. Or you can send a note on the discussion at the inbox. So I've given you 11 small program snippets, and please try and check out whether you can figure out what's happening. Okay, so the first thing that I would like to say is that to distinguish between parsing and semantics at a technical level. Really speaking, when you look at the internals of a compiler, the parser is not separate from the semantic analyzer. Okay, so you can't distinguish them. But conceptually, what the grammar captures is what is the syntax of the language, and what you add to the grammar, which is called semantic actions or rules or whatever, that takes care of. So the bullet under observation says, if I give you a context to grammar G, and if I give you an arbitrary string W, W may or may not belong to the language of G, theoretically speaking, L of G. So we say that W is syntactically correct if W belongs to LG. If you can generate W out of LG, then W is syntactically fine, but the compiler may still report errors, because usually in L of G, you have programs, some of which make sense and some of which do not make sense. In other words, it is very, very difficult, almost impossible to write a context-free grammar which will generate only semantically valid strings. It's a hard problem. And since it does not exist, we will try to distinguish the extra programs or linguistic entities which came into existence and I have some semantic errors to be cleaned up by semantic. This is the thing. Okay, so a program compiles correctly. That is, it is given that there are no compilation errors in it. However, when the program is executed, it terminates abnormally with runtime error. Who is responsible? The person who wrote the compiler, person who wrote the program, the operating system, or somebody else? Right? These questions should come to you. And if they come to you, you will also find out the correct answer. Could have even a more complicated scenario where, which happens in real life very often, I write a program, it compiles through, it runs successfully, gives me results, but I find the results are all wrong. Now what do I do? See, it's not a compiler's domain. But still, from a productivity point of view, these errors also have to be encountered. And it may have something to do with the compiler, because I can say, why didn't the compiler find out this error? And save me the botheration of making several runs before I discover the error. Okay, the rest is, I'm going to skip this. The rest you should already know. So let me go to slide 10. So I'm assuming that you know the first two passes, lexical syntax. I've said it again and again. I'll not say that again. Subsequent phases that we study, the second paragraph, are closely tied to implementation of PL. So while many features will be from C language, I will pick up linguistic issues which are not from C. If I do that, I'll explain what that linguistic feature means, and then we'll work out a transfer. It will be good, and I prefer doing it even in my course in IIT. If you want to discuss something non-trivial instead of using a very complex notation, it is first good to explain and understand what I would like to do for this linguistic feature, for loop, or while loop, or procedure call, whatever, in English. What is it that am I supposed to do? Can I describe in English my sequence of activities? And if I can do that, then we can figure out a more concise way of writing it, which is formally writing this. Often we'll see that you cannot take any arbitrary grammar for a small feature of a language and start writing a semantic analysis. While parsing, I just want a grammar which generates all my language. But when I'm doing semantic analysis, I want maybe a slightly different grammar which allows me to understand small primitive pieces of the code that is being parsed. So quite often we rewrite a context-free grammar for making it more suitable for semantic analysis. Whenever I get an opportunity to do that, I'll show you why we chose that form and not some other context-free form, which would have been also okay for parsing alone. So the question is, your grammar writing skills will have to be revised, refined, as you keep writing semantic actions. So there's a separate requirement which will come up, but we'll illustrate it with that. So let me go to slide 11. Okay, so here in the third bullet, we are saying I should figure out the meaning of a piece of code in the source, which is parsing plus semantics. And since I have to translate to the machine code eventually, wherever relevant, we like to translate it to an intermediate language. So high level language is something like you are flying at 30,000 feet above the ground. Right? You can't just like that jump and land that aircraft in no time. Okay? Slowly you will observe the pilot descends, okay, till he reaches a comfortable height from where he finally takes the landing. So this intermediate language, you can imagine, is an intermediate stage from where the final production of the assembly language code can be done. So taking the similarity further, you slowly lower the abstraction from a very high level specification like C or even high level languages which exist beyond C and slowly bring it down to assembly. And intermediate code is a vehicle through which this is done. There is no single intermediate code. Different implementers have used different intermediate codes. GCC uses GIMPL, PL1 use something else, Fortran may use something else. We will use something which most textbooks follow, which is called three address code, which I'll explain later. But the most important characteristics of any intermediate code is that it should be able to generate intermediate code from the high level language. Ease of doing that, high to an intermediate level, and it should also be possible to take this intermediate level and generate a final. That's the only characteristic. And therefore, there are many choices. There's not one. Okay, this is, you can totally read it. There's not much to add. This whole area or this whole phase of the compiler that I'm going to discuss is called static. There's nothing dynamic in it. It just examines the program text. It does not expect the program to be run. No dynamism is expected. Every feature of the language is examined statically at compile time. And it is static semantics because it analyzes properties which are not captured by the grammar. So we will need a way to describe properties beyond the grammar rules. And that is why it is. I've given you lots of examples, so don't worry about them. It will be more important to take these examples and explain what they do, which I do in this. But just to give you some idea, type analysis is what we do typically in assignment statements, expressions, and things like that. Name and scope analysis is about looking at scopes of a program, which I'll have to define. Functions can define a scope, or file can define a scope, two curly braces can define a scope. Okay, and all these will have to be understood as defined in the language by the compiler and process the code with respect to the name and scope rule. Declarations are very important. You don't generate code for declarations, but you figure out what is valid, what is defined, what is initialization, what is the type, and this dictates how you use that declaration. So this is a slightly, so these all involve slightly different kind of analysis. Once we have done type analysis, then we actually generate intermediate code. So we need expressions and statements. The bulk of the compiler does this, okay? And intermediate code generation happens along with the other phases, but we'll look at it separately. We generate intermediate code such that the semantics, okay, there are many more, but this will be somewhat basic. And we, if you can cover most of these in the three module course, I'll be very happy. Because they have depth in their own reasoning, and we'll see what depth we can cover. Okay, so examples of type analysis. This is not the full treatment. I have to write a grammar with much more detail later. But what are the issues in type analysis? This is sort of describing in English. English description of the problems and the issues that are involved in semantic analysis, which goes by the name of type. One example is, if you have A assigned B, is the variable on the left hand side compatible with the expression on the right hand side? That is one of the examples. The answer has to come through type analysis of the language. If it is true, then some code has to be generated to honor it. If it is wrong, then a compiler error has to be indicated saying why this is. Type analysis also involves things like function call and definition matching. So, for example, you have a function definition and a call, then somebody will have to tell us whether the parameters in the call are consistent with the parameters which are declared in the procedure definition. Is the return type compatible with the return value expected by a function? So, functions call versus declaration matching is also known as type analysis. It's also a part of it. Okay, if you come down, all operands, it's the third bullet says all operands of a built-in type, built-in operator are of the right type. So every operator we have to check, not only in assignment, it's just one operator. Every operator, are the operands compatible? Okay, and you know that there are operators for which fanciful things happen. For example, if I take the relational operator, less than equal to. Is A less than equal to B? I write A less than equal to B. So A and B must be comparable with respect to less than equal to. But once you compare them, the result produced is a Boolean. So I can take two elements of two structures, compare them and get true or false. So it is interesting to note that if for every operator the type has to be checked, then the result will be obtained. The result will be of the type that is expected by the language. Here is an example, 3 plus 4.5, and I've interpreted it as addition of integer 3 and 4. Okay, this could be one. The 4.5 is downgraded from a real to an integer, losing its fractional value, and then the addition is done. Or 3 is upgraded to a real, which means 3.0, and then the real addition is done between these. What should the language do? This is described by the language designer. As compiler writer, we are supposed to enforce whatever we have been told. So either we allow one conversion and figure out the resulting type, or we issue an error and the user will have to correct his or her program. Okay, now this is something important. Okay, this is some conceptual stuff. So look at this. This is somewhat in non-C language, is called, is an example from the Pascal language. Let me read it out for you. In the Pascal syntax, the code reads type ptr equals, this vertical arrow is written as pointer. So ptr is a pointer to something called an object, and what is an object is declared below. Okay, so ptr's type is defined, it is pointer to object. Okay. And what it happens is A is a pointer to object and B is a pointer. So there is some PTR type already defined. Okay, object happens to be, sorry, PTR is, some object is already defined. PTR is pointer to an object. A is also a pointer to an object and B is of type. The question one is asking is, are A and B compatible? For example, can I assign A to B? Or can I assign B to A by virtue of the other above declaration? So let me pose this question in C so that you are not lost out. So I'll just write here the equivalent of this probably in C. So you can write type def PTR. Sorry. PTR is entity, so object star PTR or something like this. So let me remove the type of altogether. Let me make it even simple. Quite confused. So here is object, and we assume that we know its definition, and here is star PTR. It is one definition. And then we have, I have another one which says, so here is object star, let's say P, and okay, let's see this. Suppose I do this in C. So I have two things. I have a PTR and I have a P. And the question is, can I write P equals PTR or can I write PTR equals P? Will these two definitions work? In general, the answer comes from feature of a language which is known as type equivalence. And this is what I am going to explain over here in a short while. This has two forms, one is called structural equivalence and the other is called name equivalence. So now let's go back to the slide. So what is the structural equivalence and what is the name equivalence? Name equivalence is very, very clear. It says two entities are name equivalent provided they have identical type. Identical type. That's all that it is. And therefore you can marry them, you can operate on them, and there will be no compatibility error. Two definitions or two entities are structurally equivalent. I should have given the definition. Okay, if they are structurally equivalent, if after substituting for the type names that occur over there, they happen to be same. For example, let me continue with our definition here. Suppose I again go back to C, though this was in Pascal. Suppose you have a struct, maybe X, which has int I, comma float. And I also have a struct y, which also happens to be similar, maybe int j and float y. So these are two structs which are being defined. And then I create some variables. So I say struct x, x1, and a struct y, y1. Now if I say x1 assigned y1, or if I say y1 assigned x1, will the language C permit it or not? Depends on whether C uses structural or naming. So what will be structural equivalence in this particular case if it was used? So let's say they will say, okay, this is x1, this is y1. The type of x1 is given by x, so this is struct x. What is type y1? Type of y1 is struct y. They have been very explicitly defined. Similar is the other. If at this level you stop and say, okay, this is x, that is y. This belongs to the family of x, that belongs to the family of y. They are not the same families, so therefore they are not name equivalent. If you did structural equivalent, then say, okay, x and y are only placeholders. They have a description of their own. What is x? X is a tuple, which is an int followed by a float, a pair of numbers. What is y? Y is also an int followed by a float. So if I substitute for the structure definitions, then I find that they are structurally the same. X and y have the same structure, same order, same type of entities. A pair int followed by float, pair int followed by float. Even order is not changed. So the structural equivalence people will say, x1 and y1 are structurally equivalent because x and y are structurally equivalent. So we have now two different notions of equivalence. One, if they have the same type, then they are name equivalent. By name, they should be the same. Same, exactly the same family. Okay. For example here, if instead of this I wrote struct x, x1, comma y1, then x1 and y1 are both of type struct x. They are of the same type, so they are name equivalent. If they are name equivalent, it is likely they are also structure equivalent. The converse is not true. So name equivalent does not, structural equivalence does not mean they are name equivalent. So this distinction has been used, and this distinction is carried through in languages by the language designers, and they will clearly say that if you have two objects to work with, or whether we should use structural equivalence or name equivalence. And it is not necessary that the language uses the same equivalence everywhere. For example, again, another example of this, so I'll be using it later. Even if in C, somebody can say, if you do int I comma j, then I can marry y and j, I and j, because they are declared through int. Okay, but that's not true. If I look at int k, then I know that both, all the three I, j, k can be, they are type compatible. You can compare them, you can assign them to each other, there is no issue whatsoever. So they are not really name equivalent, they are just structurally equivalent. If you look at integers, then I would say that integers, floats, within that family, they are all structurally equivalent. You declare an int and you can, with two ints, you can do whatever you want. Not using a type def. You use a type def, maybe slightly different things will happen. So let's move along. So type checking, one of the basic key theoretical stuff is to understand name versus structural equivalence. It was very confusing earlier. It is much more cleaner now. And in C, you should be able to clearly answer what it uses. A name and scope analysis, C and others are very simple. There's not too much challenge in there. So I'll actually take up something which makes it far more interesting, and that will be following up. What are the questions that we ask in name and scope analysis? Two basic, very simple questions. First question says, what names are visible at a program point? You take any program, you write a big program, and then you say, at this point, what are the names that I can use? What is visible here? Can I use ABC? Can I use XYZ? Okay, and the ABC, XYZ could be locals, could be parameters, could be globals, could be static, anything. Declared anywhere, this file, another file. This question, if we can answer, then we know scope and naming rules of the line. What names are visible at any program point, the compiler should be able to clearly figure out. So should the reader of the program. You can ask a converse question. If I give you a name instead of program point, X, variable X, can you tell me all parts of the program where this definition of X is used or can be used? Not easy, can be. So given any name, where all in the program it is visible, is another question you can ask. Take a point and ask what is visible here, or take a name and ask all regions of the program where it is visible, where it is accessible. How do we answer this question? Is interesting. Depends again on the linguistic rules. So here is something, I'll go at it slightly slowly. So this is language Pascal, split over different. So if you go to slide 15, at the bottom of it, it has some part of this. So the whole start thing starts with a program S. It did not come very nicely. Program S should have come on the next page. This is the starting. This is the Pascal syntax. Okay. These are all parameterless procedures. So no parameters are there. Okay. It could have had a parameter, but it doesn't have. Maybe since I will be explaining this, I will write it out here so that you can see it in one go. So program S is at the highest level. Okay. And then follows this is, you can write a little bit. So in nested inside this are two declarations, which are A, X, this Pascal. Nested inside S, nested procedure definition are not allowed in C, but this language allows it, which makes it much more interesting. So here is a parameterless procedure R, which is nested inside procedure S. R has a local declaration I, okay, var is the way of doing it. There is a procedure T, which is nested inside procedure R. Again, it is parameterless, so semicolon. There are two variables M and N declared over there. After var comes a body of T. So here something may happen, whatever comes here is supposed to be the body of T. After body of T, T is now over. After this comes the body of R. So whatever the procedure R wants to do. Okay, so now procedure R is over. At the same level as procedure R, there is procedure E. It's yet another procedure, parameterless. And at the level of procedure E, there is another procedure Q. Q has some local variables, K, V. I'm writing it out from the slide. You can also check it out from there. Okay, and inside this, there's a function. Don't worry about functions and procedures. Treat everything as function to avoid confusion. Now, this has a parameter. So this has two parameters. A function has these parameters. The function has two variables, I, J. And then there is a body of P, so P closes here. Then there is a body of Q, may not be very easily visible. And then there is a body of the program or the main. So are these functions available? Yes, even today, Pascal language will allow this thing to happen. So what the question that we are asking there, I'll ask over this, I'll go through slowly. Okay, because I may ask you to answer such questions in the quiz and you should be able to answer. So now this is about name and scope analysis. So here I am looking at visibility of names. So I can take any program point and ask this question, what is visible there? On the slides I had asked, what is visible in the body of P? So let me change the question and ask, let's say, what is visible in the body, this point P that I put out here? This is my point of interest. The point of interest is just after the variable declaration has completed in procedure Q, what are the names that are visible between this and before the function is declared? So now, Pascal has a very funny rule and therefore it is more challenging to implement it. Pascal rules for visibility goes like, inside the procedure, what is visible? First is all the local variables. Whatever are local variables of a function are all visible, all locals. This I am sure you would understand as sort of easy. So all local variables, then what is accessible? What is accessible are the immediately nested procedure, the procedure in which it is nested. Immediate procedure in which it is immediately nested. So only one level up. I'll explain that as I go along. Is there anything else? The answer is yes. All names in the immediately nested procedure. These are all visible. In the procedure in which it is immediately nested. Immediately nested. So above, in point 2, whatever I have stated. To make life simple, let me first example, I can take the point and do it slowly. Suppose I ask this question at this point over here. Now Pascal, like many other languages today, most other languages today, is a recursive language, which means a name can always call itself. So S can definitely call S, that comes out over here. That's the first. The procedure that it can call is itself. Then what it can call is, what is local inside it? So A, comma X are local variables and therefore they are visible at the point I have drawn. But I have said here, remember the first is all locals of the procedure. Now Pascal treats all procedure definitions nested inside it also as local. Just like var are local variables, procedure R is nested inside R, S, sorry. So R is also visible to S, because it is immediately nested. Now from R to the body of R, nothing is visible now, because this part is within R. It cannot see anything inside R, but it can see R. It can call the procedure R, but it cannot call any of its locals. So R is local in S, and therefore the procedure R is callable inside S, in the body of S, which is right at the bottom. Here you can call. After R, what is there? At the same level of R, if I have drawn the picture correctly, is E. Procedure E. So E procedure is also local to S, and therefore S can call the procedure E also, but not what is hidden inside E. It cannot call that. At the same level of R and E is procedure Q. So procedure Q can also be called inside the function, the program or procedure. So the rules apply like this. Everything local in S amounts to the name itself S, procedure name R, procedure E, procedure Q and nothing else. And the variables are A and X and nothing. So now let me pose the question where I have actually asked so that you should be able to answer. So let me concentrate now on this point, which is after variable K, V. So I'm inside procedure Q and we are asking what is visible inside Q at that point. Actually, this point is not very correct. So let me slightly, maybe I'll shift it later. What I've answered you actually is what can be called in the body of S. Because everything I have, if you just stop here, I have not seen the rest. After I have processed, so at this point, these are not true. This is actually true in the body of S, strictly speaking. So the body of S can call all of them because I have processed the whole program. If I don't process, I can't see what is true. So after processing the whole program, the body of S can call S, R, E, and Q and can access A and X. So if I insist on this point, then on this point, what is visible is the variable K and V, of course, because they are very much been declared. The procedure Q itself, because you have already seen it. Now, what is Q nested in? immediate procedure in which Q is nested happens to be S, right? So it can call S because Q is nested in S, just one level up. And it also can call whatever is immediately local in S. Now at this point you have not seen everything of S, or maybe you have. You know that A comma X are accessible, so he can also see A comma X, which is local to S. He can see R, he can see E, and he can see Q. You can already call it that. It can also call procedures R and E because they are also nested immediately in S. So if you have reached your processing up to this stage only, then at this point what is visible are the local variables K and V. The procedure calls Q, S, R and E because they are immediately visible in S in which it is nested, and the local variables of S which are A and X. Nothing. But what is visible in the body of Q? That's a different question. If you go to the body of Q, then function P is also local in Q. Then P will also get added. If I go right beyond P, then what is visible in the body of Q are whatever I have written here, plus add the function definition P, but not what is nested inside. So this will be made very clear in the slides. So first one has to state the rules, the static scoping rules of nested procedures. That's what it becomes more interesting. It is called nested procedure definitions, which is not allowed in C, C++, okay, and many other languages, which loses this beauty of processing. So the static scoping rules of C, C++ will not apply here, but for Pascal it says all locals in the procedure of interest, all the names which are in immediately the procedure in which it is immediately nested, just one level high procedure, and everything that is visible in that procedure, so only the names in that procedure. So this you can see the very interesting set which keeps coming up. The challenge will be, can we write a grammar which can take such procedure declarations? Okay, so I'll go back to my slide. Okay, which can handle the kind of piece of code which I have given on slides 15 and 16. And not only do this, but actually tell us at every program point what is visible, and maybe at the end say what all visible after the entire program is processed, what all visible in the bodies of different procedures. It is not going to be easy because you have to keep entering a procedure, keep updating the visibilities, come out of a procedure, you have to make the appropriate changes so that you get this final result. We have done it over here. And if you can understand that, it means you have understood fairly interesting case of nested equivalence. So on slide 17, the rules are very clearly given. The names declared locally in the procedure of which this program is a part of. The names of all enclosing procedures, names of all enclosing procedures, and the names immediately declared within such. It's not the immediate one, it looks like it can see all the enclosing procedures and the names immediately visible in there. Okay. So you have to change my interpretation slightly. So if you go back here to the procedure P, then you can see lot of things are visible over. So on slide 18, I have given a complete worked out example, okay, in which it has been shown. For example, if you look at the body of T, which is, body of T is not interesting. Let's look at the body of P over here, that is in the fourth row of this table. The fourth row, it says in body of P, you have I, J, Y, Z and capital P. Let's see that. So if you go back to P again, you can see in P, you have got I, J, which is local. Y, Y, Z, because they are parameters, they are also local entities. Okay, and Y, P, because P is a name, recursive call is allowed. So just if you look at the locals of P, and don't look at the outer context, which is what a language like C, C++ does, but includes globals, which are not there. So I, J, Y, Z, and P are typically the locally declared names, which is very clearly separated. Now if you look at the outer context, what is this function p enclosed in? Who surrounds function p at different levels? So p is immediately nested in q, and q is immediately nested in. So these are at the same level. So q is not nested in that, but q is directly nested in. Slides formatting problem is there. So q is directly nested in s. So p is nested in q, q is nested in s. So both the procedure names q and s are visible inside p and therefore callable also. So by the immediate procedure rule, if you look at it, q and s become the second component, the second part of the rule, which allows these to be visible. And then it says declarations of names immediately within such procedure. So I have to examine q and s, look at the locals and put them over. So because p is nested in q immediate and kv are local to q, therefore kv gets into the declarations because of q. Now q is nested in what? Q is nested in also, sorry, p is also nested in s. And if you look at s, we observe there are a and x are visible over there. Okay, so therefore you find ax is coming from there. Now in s you are also these two names r and e visible. Let's go and check it out again. Why is r visible in s? Because at this level, variable level, declaration a and x is same as procedure r. So r is the local declaration of a function within s. And after r is over, e is the local declaration within s. Q is also within S, but that we have already encountered and taken care of. So E and R are two local procedure declarations, again not allowed in C++, which gets added over here. So at the end, what you can see in the body of P, or what you can legally use, are the variables I, J, Y, Z, K, V, A, X coming from different scopes, and the procedure names P, Q, S, R, and D. So read this carefully, and if you are able to synthesize this, then you have understood this complex but interesting scoping rules of Pascal. C is not complicated at all. For example, since I am saying this, why shouldn't I digress and tell us, had I been doing this for C, what I needed to do? C++ is a little more challenging because it has got other stuff. What will happen in C? So C language and visibility. First, we know that in C language, you can write many functions. You can write functions. So let's say use some function, some other function F2. And maybe there's a function main. You can have any number of functions. I'm just assuming some. And there are some declarations here which are called globals. Firstly, in C, or as well as in C++, function names are declared as global. So you cannot hide F2 within F1. It is not allowed. Compiler will throw you out. These are global names, which means anybody can call F1 and F2 after they are defined. Once F1 is defined, F2 can be called in F1 can be called in F2. But F2 cannot be called in F1. Definition comes later. Main can call both F1 and F2. You cannot hide function definitions. So function definitions are global. So F1, F2, and main are sort of available everywhere after they have been defined. Globals are available everywhere. What all is visible? If you are inside the body of F1, for example, all the globals, okay, and all the functions which are declared or defined before are available. And of course, the parameters. So in C, since you cannot hide a function definition, there is not too much of challenge in trying to figure out what is visible at a given program point. All I have to do is process the function, figure out all the locals, all the parameters, okay, and the globals, which include function definitions, and I'm done. It's very easy. I don't have to go back and forth. Okay. So the visibility rules of C are simpler, and therefore it makes life a little simpler. But not everything is so obvious. I can also have a pair of braces inside a function. And this defines a scope by itself. So what is visible inside it may not be visible outside, and so on. So we'll have to figure out, in the presence of nested scopes like this which are allowed, how to handle this, which we can look at later. So how to handle visibility when you can have nested scopes like this? You can have nested scopes also because of a struct within a struct. So there are issues out there, but they are not as complex as what I showed you right here, the static scoping rules of languages like Pascal, Algol, and so on. So these instructive, if I give you a fragment and I give you the rules, you should be able to write a processing scheme, which is a semantic analysis. Okay, so I'll move ahead with declaration. Is there any question by anybody? So in declaration processing, depending on the language, a lot of things are done. Since I want to cover a bit of declaration processing today, which is my purpose. First thing is, of course, uniqueness checks, which are insisted by the language, defined by the language. My identifier must be declared uniquely in a declaration. Once you note down the declaration, I must also keep it somewhere so that subsequent uses of this declaration can be resolved with this particular definition or some other definition. Okay. Once you get into a symbol table like thing, one worries about the structure. Symbol table is not available after the program is compiled. Compiler creates and throws it after it is done with the user. Address resolution. Okay, we'll have to worry about this later. It all depends on what are the different addresses. We'll talk about later about stacks, heaps, globals, wherever they are kept, and the compiler has to generate a memory reference based on what is the address resolution mechanism, which we'll see later. But these are the issues which will have to be handled while you are handling declarations. If I have a struct within a struct and you are referring to a particular variable there, how does the compiler figure out where this entity is in its memory, and how does it allow you to assign or access to these entities? That we get into declaration first. Intermediate code generation is a quick example, not very accurate, but to start you with. So let's say you have got this expression, which is again in Pascal-like notation. You can treat it as C also, but then the syntax will change. X is assigned a two-dimensional array A. This first subscript expression is Y, the second is Z, and this is compared with less than B. So X is assigned a value which is an array access compared with a variable B, and we have said that everything is integer. On the right hand side, A is an integer array, two-dimensional. B happens to be an integer value, and we want to assign to X the value of A, Y, Z compared with B. If you are not familiar with Pascal, notation should not be a hindrance. So here is this same entity which are written out there in a different form, let's say written out in C syntax, so that you are able to figure out what I am saying. This is what I have given in C, is to be written as, without any change, A. This is what I mean. Where it is given that this is the integer, int A is also an integer, and X is given to be a real. What does compiler do? Really non-trivial. So first the issue before the solution, which is there on the slide. The first issue is, somewhere in memory this array A has been stored. It's a two-dimensional array. Okay. So let's say A, I have to assume something. In these notes I have assumed 1, 1 is the starting address. So let's say though C does differently. Here is from A11, it's a 10 by 20 array, so the last element is A10 20. Okay, there are 200 elements like this. If I use this, these are somewhere in memory, we don't know where. Compiler has to figure it out. Now somebody says, in this array I want to refer to A, Y, or Z. Please give me the value which is stored in A, Y, or Z. Access that value, compare it with B. If it is less, it is true, then assign this true value to X. If it is false, then assign the false value. So the first thing, without too much, because I'll do this in a great detail later, you observe that I have done something over here. Let me go back to the slide. So on the slide, you observe some calculations which are there. Very quickly I'm explaining, because I'll do this along with compiler activity in great amount of detail. So why does he do that y into 20? So I've assumed 1. So what does it mean? It means that there are 10 cross 20 arrays. There are 10 rows of 20 columns, which means each row has 20 elements. So there are 20 columns. Every row has 20 values, and there are 10 such rows. Now, since you are looking at a certain, so this calculation depends on what we are trying to do. So this says, if you want to access the yth row in AYZ, then you have to go past certain number of elements. So here it says you have to go past 20 such rows, assuming, right? So when you go past 20 such rows, you reach the AYth row in which you are looking at an element. So this, when you add Z, you actually get A of YZ. So the address calculation formula which is happening over. And then to this, whatever we have done, to this value, which is T1 equals T1 plus Z, I have calculated some address. You keep it over there. Now you do address A minus 21, I'll tell you later. There's some calculation happening out there, some constant. This is offset. So the T1 is the base, T2 is the base address from where the array starts. T1 is the offset in the memory. And if you index T2 with T1, you get the same element as A, Y, O. Who has figured it out, the compiler? Why has he done the calculation? Because he knows the language that he is translating. This is what needs to be done. So T2 indexed with T1 in the fourth intermediate code that is generated is same as the array access A, Y, Z. Now this he copies into a temporary T. Sorry, I did a mistake over there. I said B is integer. It looks B is real. So A, Y, Z is integer. So T3 is integer. And you have to compare a T3 with a real B. You can't compare integer with reals. So again, some conversion takes place. So T3 is converted into real, so that both the operands of the operator less than become real. AYZ converted from integer to real into T4. B is already real. So now there's an intermediate code, which is very funny, but we are going to use such code in the later stages. Which says if T4 is less than B, go to 9. You can see there's a label here, go to 9. If what if T4 is not less than B? The condition is false. If it is so, then it says in the next one, T5 equals 0, T5 equals 1, and X equals T5. What is this T5 doing? It's basically manipulating true or false. If AYZ is less than B is true, then it's assigning the value true, which is 1 to T5. If AYZ is not less than B, they are assigning 0 to T5. And this true or false, whatever comes from the expression, is assigned to T5. So observe the idiosyncrasy. Either straight line code X equals AYZ less than B. The intermediate code has used an if then else kind of a pattern and generated finally the code. So this requires fairly tricky arithmetic to be done, semantic analysis to be done, array elements accessed from anywhere depending on the array mapping into the memory, and then the appropriate code generated whenever the expression has this relational operands, then an if kind of code is also generated. Who has decided all this? The compiler implementer has decided. And he has worked it out along with the grammar rules, so that as the parser is processing small bits, when the parser processes X, it does something. When the parser processes assignment, he may do something. It processes AYZ, maybe some of these activities are taken and so on. Right? So all of this is happening along with parsing. The parsing is saying this is fine. Semantic analysis says, let me generate some intermediate code. And they're going hand in. Okay, so firstly, why do we not use simply a context-free grammar? You can create many, many such examples for those who are theoretically inclined. Here are two simple answers given on slide 21. It says declaration of a variable before its use is a requirement in most programming languages for semantic analysis. You cannot use a variable X unless you have declared it before the point of use. So semantic analysis requires you generate strings in which a use is preceded by a definition or declaration. If I could write a context-free grammar for it, I don't have to do any semantic analysis. So the grammar will throw out strings which are used before declaring. The first one, the Read at Leisure, says that there is a simple language which shows that doing this is not context-free. So no CFG can allow you to check use before a declaration. This is a formal language, WCW. The second language, and you can create many more such examples, which is also not context-free, can be used to model procedure definitions and calls. You define a function and you call a function. And you are doing parameter matching. Is the type compatible? Same parameter, same type. All these can be handled if this language AN, BM, C and DM given into was context. This language, fortunately or unfortunately, is also not context. Thereby basically saying that large number of semantic analysis relies on the fact that a context-free grammar cannot do them. So parsing cannot take care of semantic analysis. Once this fact is accepted, then we have to do extra syntax issues, like do things more than writing a grammar and get away with semantic analysis. I think I've spoken for a long time. Again, I would love to see if there are any questions. I have no clue whether you are following it, you are not following it, you are having difficulties or not. So anybody from anywhere, any input about the pace, the material, the examples, anything that you think is not being followed in. Semantics is not easy. Okay, parsing itself is not very easy. Semantics obviously is much more interesting but complex. But we do it every time. Every time you are writing a program, you are writing, taking care of the semantics while writing. The only interesting question is, how is the compiler doing it behind us? So any issue which you would like me to address or readdress what I have already been talking. Okay, before I continue, let me give you a piece of sort of homework. I intended to cover up to a certain point, but with no response, I don't know, because these are not very obvious things. They may be given in the book in some form. There's a lot of reading between the lines. Okay, so before I forget, before we break, okay, for today, I'll be finishing soon. I'll ask you to read up to slide 35. Okay, you don't have to read the implementation of S-attributed definition, which I can do later. But you must come prepared, read up to page 35, slide 35. And then I'll tell you, after skipping, you should also come read with some material. Okay. So in fact, I would suggest you read up to slide 44. So I'll write it out so you, all of you can see. We'll start with a discussion on slide 44. And then we'll proceed on the next page. Okay. So please read. Okay, so I read out what I have written in case you cannot read this. So before instructions, those who will be attending lecture 2, you have to read up to slide 44, because I intended to go up to here, but without response, I just couldn't figure out what was happening. Okay, and just either you post your doubts or queries or come prepared with your doubts and queries. I'll spend 15 minutes at the beginning of the lecture 2 to sort out their doubts on these topics. Then I'll move into the actual semantic analysis for different. So all your doubts about semantic analysis, practice, theory, whatever, you can actually address out here. Okay, so what I'll let's see, still there are no questions. So let me give you a small tips about how it is to be written. I think there are some pictures which are missing. You have to make sure they are, should have been there. Okay, after discussing in slide 21, which talks about the fact that many linguistic processing for semantics is beyond context-free grammars, we try and give a way in which semantics can be written. Okay, this is a very standard way that the Aung San Suu Kyi Unman's book actually introduces. So I've stuck to that so that you can refer to that material. So syntax-directed definition is supposed to be one way of doing it. What happens in that? What happens in that is what you should read up and ask me. So you write a syntax, a context-free grammar like I have shown below. This context-free grammar you observe is ambiguous. It is not the most desirable one, but it doesn't matter. It has an assignment statement as the basic grammar rule for which you are trying to, we are trying to generate code. So we first write out this, and now we want to decide what semantic analysis we do. The common philosophy for doing semantic analysis is to attach attributes which are defined by us. Attributes means extra variables, extra information that we want to keep with the non-term. So the non-terminals in this, in the grammar rule which I am showing you on 22, are a non-terminal S, which generates non-terminal E, which generates expression, and there are various forms for E. You can add two sub-expressions to create an expression. You can multiply, you can do a unary minus, or it can just be an ID. So given all of this, we have to decide what do we want to do. So typically, what we would like to do is, in full detail, though we have taken a very small issue here, out here, is to probably check that the expression is well formed and no problems with the expression. If you are trying to add something, there are two operands to add. Trying to multiply, there are two operands to multiply, and so on. And after everything is done, you'd like to generate code. So we define now attributes for capital E if we need. We define attributes for capital S if we need. And above all of that, we try and generate. So observe below that I have something called code out there, s.code. It means there is an attribute called code. The attribute called code is attached to non-terminal S, attached to non-terminal E, and all it is saying is that if I go through a certain rule, then E.code will have some piece of code that I generate. That's all it is. It is a variable, it can have anything. Okay? So I create a placeholder for doing some semantic analysis. There is no type check here, at least here I have not shown you any type check. So if you go to the next slide, which is 23, you will observe that some codes have been put, some actions have been put against the rules. S goes to ID assigned E. I have given in the slide how to read it. S.code is same as E.code. So assign to S.code, E.code. Then generate a primitive statement which is ID.place equal to something. You can see there is a function call which will do something. There is a concatenation operator which says join something. Okay, so this is the way we are trying to write our act. So more interesting is gen goes to E goes to E1 plus. So we assume that code for E1 is already written. We assume that code for E2 is already written. So E1.code equals E2.code. And then to this two pieces of code which you have already seen and known, please add a new code which adds E1, E2 and puts it in a place. Okay. So this is what, you know, intuitively this whole thing is doing. You have to get a feel for it so that I can proceed faster and also with clarity. So syntax directed definition is first finding attributes, writing attributes like e.place, like e.code, and attaching them to when I should like to evaluate them against which rule. So this is one way of doing semantic analysis, creation of attributes, creation of rules, and relating the semantic actions or attribute evaluations. The explanations are there, subsequent slides, please read through. Then it turns out that the syntax directed definitions are only cosmetic, they're not very useful, because while they establish the relation what is to be done, they don't say when the relation. So immediately after SDD, syntax directed definition, which is only a very formal way of doing, which you can see. Okay. I'll skip the inherited attributes and all that. We come to something called translation scheme in on slide 31. This is what I'll be doing for the rest of the course in the remaining two lectures. So we will be writing syntax-directed translation schemes for various semantics. So SDTS is something that you should read. And if you are not able to understand, please flag the questions. We will be writing syntax-directed translation schemes for doing array processing, for doing expression evaluation, assignment statements, control flow, everything. If it is clear what is a syntax-directed translation scheme, then writing out for various languages. So this is what, there is an example, please read through. It's a very interesting example. This requires parsing. It requires, please go on page on slide 32. Okay, so I've asked you to read again, I'll repeat since I'm running out of time and no questions are coming up. Read up to slide 44, collect all your doubts, questions, post it in discussion forum or bring it over to the next lecture. You've already seen it, but once more. And we'll spend 15 minutes or more if required in the beginning of the second lecture trying to explain your doubts. And after that, we can really start doing semantic analysis continuously after. For various linguistic features, I have already included some. You are most welcome to ask how to compile some other linguistic issues which you have in C or in any other language, and we'll see if we have the right material for this. So, the last 5 minutes, I'll insist on some questions. I have no idea some time back. Any questions, any feedback, nothing. I also said I seem to be talking to myself, no audience at the other end. But still no interrupt has come, so I don't know whether you are there, you are not there, whether you are finding the material too complex, too easy. So if you don't give a feedback, it's very difficult to continue doing these deliberations. Yeah, so you can, if you want, whoever is interacting with me, you can post. So again, to repeat what I was saying, this translation scheme is to show you that I can take a grammar and I can create, you know, some translation which may not necessarily be compilation related. And this is an exercise in translation scheme writing. It is not required really for compilation. Okay, and your question about infix to postfix, prefix, etc., relevant only if they are defined over these operators. Okay, so we have to see what is an infix or prefix notation for a higher level operator for binary. But anyway, this is not really required for compilation. Okay, so I hope you will have many more doubts when we join next week for lecture 2. Signing off from here. Thanks for joining me.